You're listening to the audio production of The God Who Sees, Audio Bible Studies, by Kathie Lee Gifford with Joanne Moody, published by Harper Christian Resources and presented by Kathie Lee Gifford. These audio studies are a unique learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, this production includes high-quality live recordings that cover the important points from each chapter, as well as relevant material from other sources.
Hi, everybody. So glad you're with us. This is my dear friend, Joanne Moody. I have come to know Joanne through the years as one of the great biblical scholars I know. She is an evangelist. She is a pastor. She has her own incredible story of being healed that you got to go and learn about, because look at this woman. This woman was paralyzed basically for 14 and a half years and could not walk and was in deep, 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 horrendous pain. And here she is, walking miracle, aren't you?
I just, every day, I'm astounded by the grace of God. What fun to be with you.
I know. We're going to have so much fun. We're into now The God Who Sees, which is, of course, you're seeing a lot of it behind us. That is the amazing Nicole C. Mullen, who started this whole thing with us, with the first oratorio that we did called The God Who Sees. And in this one, we're going to study Hagar. We're going to study Ruth. We're going to study David hiding from Saul, King Saul, all those years in the Judean desert. And we're going to go into Mary Magdalene's story, which is, she's one of my favorite characters in the Bible. Most of these stories, in fact, all of them in this oratorio, were based on the place where all of it happened. And that would be the desert, the Judean wilderness. You can't read the Bible without running into the Judean wilderness almost all the time. But I remember the first time I went to the Judean desert, the wilderness, I was stunned how close it was to Jerusalem. It's just a couple of miles. That's what's very surprising. You can go from the topography is just beautiful. And you can go from Galilee in the north, where it's the Jezreel Valley and it's agricultural and there's palm trees in Jericho. And a mile later, you're at the Dead Sea. It's actually fascinating.
I love that when you're describing that, you can think about where the apostles walked with Jesus, where all these different places were. You can go through the Old Testament and look at all the stories and think, oh, you know, did they walk for 14 years to get to the desert? You have no idea, but I love that. Brings it home. So many stories that run through my mind.
The thing that I remember the most about it is how it's you look at it at first, the desert, and you say, it's so God-forsaken.
Yeah.
Well, that's a really bad word, because nothing is God forsaken.
No, there's life,
and there are streams of water that are hidden. Mm-hmm. There's plant life that you don't expect to see. There are birds. They're getting something sustenance from somewhere, you know. And it's a mysterious place, but it has its great natural beauty. But it has the beauty too of God's limitless intelligence.
What was your favorite thing when you first went to Israel and you walked in? Because I know you hiked a lot in the desert in those first couple of trips you went. What was the most exciting thing that you learned besides everything was so close?
It's just difficult terrain.
Yeah.
There are things called the wadis there, and that's where the
sounds like a Star Wars character.
It does sound like but they're the crevices you see in the hills, and they look just like crevices that have been chiseled out or something like that. It's actually where the rain, the storms, when they finally do come during the rainy season, the floods come from the mountains, and if you're in a wadi when that happens, you're deady. If you're in the wadi when that happens. And that's the kind of stuff when you're sitting there and you're looking up at those, you know, and many people have been caught in them.
Wow.
You know, they're just caught in them, and there's really no way out. And I can't hike the way I used to, because I was when I started doing. I was 17 when I first went to Israel.
Oh my gosh!
Yeah, and I'm in my late 20s now, so it's just nothing's as easy. So I don't think that I'm ever going to be able to study the way I always have. This latest trip of mine, I think I just sort of started to feel like, oh, okay, Kath, you know, maybe. But maybe we've got to find a new way up the mountain.
But you'll never stop going.
No, but I'll never stop growing. And we're so glad that you guys are joining us for the study. I mean, there is something new every single day I learn in this beautiful creation God provided for us. It's still a garden. We just have to go looking for it
sometimes.
Yes,
absolutely. I think that when you really study scripture, you see what the wilderness journey parallels. You see the metaphors, you see the symbolism. But I know, based on your stories and other friends who've gone, there's nothing like visiting. I think everyone who believes in Messiah should visit the Holy Land. I think that there's so much to be learned. And it's impossible, although our study's really, really rich, and you will see it come to life. You'll see the characters of the Bible come to life through their desert experiences and through our own parallels. We see the Messiah woven throughout. But going there, I think, should be a destination for everybody.
We're on everybody's bucket list. Yep. All right, so what's the word we have for desert?
So the word desert and wilderness we'll use interchangeably because there are different aspects to study. And in the Hebrew and the Greek, we learn different things. But what we need to know as a backstory is that the desert in these areas is so dry and it's so arid, but it had good roots to go through it. People didn't want to stay there unless they were running from the law or they were seeking solace with God. What an interesting thing. We have outlaws and we have people seeking solace with God. And when we look at it—
Hiding in case of David.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And so when we look at his life, we also have to look at the life of John the Baptist. John the Baptist lived most of his life in the wilderness, and yet think about him being the forerunner for Jesus, and he heard from God in the desert.
Of one crying from the wilderness.
Exactly.
Prepare the way.
Prepare the way. Here we are. Yeah. The Byzantine era had a fantastic explosion of monks seeking this refuge in the desert. So in the 6 AD, there's such an interesting explosion of these people looking for God in the wilderness, and there were more than 65 monasteries out in the middle of nowhere, people looking for God in the desert. We never want to have a desert experience, personally.
Yeah.
But isn't it interesting how many people sought him in those places?
And most of the real lessons in life that I have grappled with and wrestled with the most have been in the desert.
Yes.
When I saw the wilderness for the first time, it just takes your breath away, and I just thought, nobody could survive this.
Yeah, yeah.
And don't we often, as believers, say, how am I ever going to survive this? But there are so many stories in the Bible of people that felt that way.
Yes.
Who would we read about in the Bible, Joanne, who also had desert experiences like that?
Well, I think that when we look at Abraham, look at his life, Abram, who became Abraham, he was in a wilderness type of experience. So whether it's a physical desert or it's a spiritual desert, we're talking about the same thing. Mm-hmm. When you look at a desert as we're looking at behind us, it seems that it is void of human, of having any human in it. But we know through the Bible, people survived there. It's also depicted in the Bible as a spiritual place of exile.
Yes.
So it's interesting that people that God spoke to in the desert became great leaders. And in our story of the Israelites who wandered around for 40 years, what was the purpose of that? Okay, there are all kinds of things that we can pull out of scripture of why this happened. But really, God wanted to speak to his people. Mm-hmm. So we've got over and over again, in the wilderness, in a desert, this is where God spoke to Moses. There's a scripture that's so rich, if I can read it, it's Deuteronomy 2:7. It says, "For the Lord your God has blessed you in all that you've done. He has known your wanderings through this great wilderness. These 40 years the Lord your God has been with you, you have not lacked a thing." Okay, in the natural, the desert, how do we even find water? You said that there were streams there, right? Yeah. They're hidden.
Yes.
There's hidden foliage there. There are things hidden in our own hearts that God unearths in a desert season. Mm-hmm. This is what was happening for the Israelites as they wandered around. God captivated them, trying to speak to them, because all of the rest of the distractions were taken away. In the wilderness, God met Elijah in 1 Kings chapter 19. In the desert, and we talked a little bit about John the Baptist being that voice calling from the wilderness. I wonder if you think about the times in that culture, could John the Baptist have lived that radical of a lifestyle if he didn't live in the desert? What do you think?
I don't know. I just don't know how he could survive on locusts.
Oh, that makes me gag.
Locusts and honey.
Is that one?
Honey, what's for dinner? Honey.
Again and again. Just a little.
No, I just.
Yeah, just a little crunchy.
Yeah, there's a lot going on there. But no matter what is going on there, what is never changes is that God sees us in the midst of it all.
And he speaks to us in the worst parts of our lives, which we call wilderness journeys. In every one of the stories in the Bible that we can pull where people were exiled, they were in a wilderness, they were in a desert, there were miracles. I really think some people who are watching and participating with this Bible study need to know that God is a God of miracles, and that in your worst desert season that you might be living through right now, he hasn't forgotten you, he hasn't abandoned you, he will never leave you or forsake you. God has promised that he will be with you to the end. He is the God El Elyon, from everlasting to everlasting. Your covenant in Jesus, Messiah, Yeshua, the one in whom all good things come, has never been broken because of your circumstances.
So somebody who was really suffering and had felt completely abandoned was our Hagar.
Yes.
Hey, tell us about Hagar. What does her name mean?
So she's an interesting Bible character because her story's complex. Her name actually means forsaken, but it also means to flee. So if you study the Bible, you'll see that names mean so much. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean you forever carry the history of that name.
Right.
Because we will see through her lineage as we study her what happens. God never leaves you or abandons you.
So she was Egyptian.
Yep.
And what's her background briefly? We're going to get into her a lot in the next study, but she, yeah. She was she given to Pharaoh, from Pharaoh to?
So we don't know, because if we look at our canon, our Christian canon, and the books that are included, there's not a lot about her backstory except that she is Egyptian, right? And she was given, in the apocryphal book, she's given to Sarah, who's Sarai at that time, but we don't know. You know, apocryphal books aren't in our Christian canon. So what we do know from our Old Testament and New Testament that are included in the Christian canon, we say that we don't know where she comes from.
We know she's. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.